I do not have rights to this music. Here's Ani.
Hello, hello, and welcome. Here I am back again, the Silver Fox. I'm Ani Crane, and I'm the Silver Fox and the Queen of Fun. And I'm so excited to be here today because my friends tell me your life is so glorious, you should bottle it and sell it. But I'm not gonna sell it, I'm gonna tell it. I'm gonna tell you all my secrets. I've had three lifetimes already. I've been a mother, a teacher, and a psychic. I'm an author of two books, my memoir, How I Arrived Here, which you can get on Amazon, a little plug. And I wrote this lovely How to Be Happy book with my best friend, Kate, who's the illustrator. And that you can get on Barnes & Noble's. I've also written the play, Act 3, which was performed at Studio 620 to a full house, I might add. And let's see what else. Oh, I have a degree in communication. So what I'm saying is I'm a woman of a certain age. I'm a wise woman, and I have plenty of experience. And as the Queen of Fun, I always advocate have fun. If it's not fun, don't do it. So I'm going to share with you my tips. I have six. I started out with five. Now I have six. I had to add in one. So my tips are, number one, have fun. If it's not fun, don't do it. Laugh a lot. However you get to laugh, go to a funny movie, whatever it is. Number two, express your creativity. Everyone has talent. Find out what it is and just do it. That's your gift. That's why you're here. Number three, go for peace of mind. Silence, meditate. In the silence, it speaks to you. You get your ideas. Number four, how to stay young at heart? Move it. Walk, run, play, dance, bike, swim, whatever it is. But back to number one, let it be fun. So I love all my exercise. Otherwise, I wouldn't do it. If I didn't love it, I wouldn't do it. So, and number five is eat well, which I'm still working on. Enjoy your food. Let it be a pleasure. Let it be nourishing. And let it be moderate, in moderation. So we should enjoy our food. It's one of life's pleasures. Why not? And here's the one I just added. I was with a friend, actually my videographer, the other day. We were sitting in a park eating lunch, and I said, I must add nature. I must add nature to my tips for living well. So be in nature, breathe in nature. It's so healing. Okay, so those are my tips. Now moving on, I'm so excited. I have a very special guest who came to us from afar, from the other side of Florida, from Palm City, Florida. It's Christiana Godot. I'll check how to pronounce it. She is a full-time tarot professional for 25 plus years. She offers readings, coaching, mentoring. She is the real deal. And she's an author. She's written two books. And she's also the founder of StarCon, which is a big meeting of all tarot people once a year. She initiated that. And she also has a podcast, which she calls StarCast. So she is all over the internet. I'm very happy. We've been psychic sister friends for a number of years. I'll check with her on that. I'm pretty sure it's 5+. And I'd like you to help me welcome Christina Godet. Welcome. I do apologize firstly for the pronunciation.
Ah, yes.
Please say your last name.
Well, I'll say my first name first. Christiana.
Christiana
Godet.
Godet. Let me say it again. Please welcome Christiana Godet.
Well, thank you so much, Ani. It's a real pleasure to be with you.
It's a pleasure to be here. And we just finished up a lovely tarot meetup, which Christiana led. We had a bunch of ladies who were just enjoying the time and the space with her. She was teaching us things we never knew. She was giving us readings. It was heavenly. It was heavenly. So I'd like to ask you, what is your most exciting thing that you're into right now, currently?
Right now, this minute, it's really two things. Mm-hmm. I am finishing up book number 3, so I'm very excited about that. And as you mentioned, StarCon, our international conference, it's a tarot and divination conference. We're a hybrid conference, meaning that we meet online and in person, so you can join us either way.
Options.
We have options, and we just had our first hybrid event this past January. In 2021, we were going to be in person, but we weren't for obvious reasons.
So
we're getting it together for number 3 in January 2023.
I was at the first one, by the way. Yes, I did.
Very good.
I followed you right to the other side, so to speak. Yeah, that was great. But I didn't know at that time that you were the founder.
Really?
I didn't realize it.
Well, there you go.
I knew you were like the dynamic presence. That I knew. But yeah, that's great. But then actually I discovered you north of here in Lutz.
Right.
You used to be in Panera on a Sunday. You'd give a lovely lesson and...
Yeah, tarot meetups. I run a tarot meetup at Panera in Palm City where I am now.
Yeah.
And when I come to town, I'll do it like tomorrow. We'll do it tomorrow.
You'll do it. So anybody near Lutz can catch her tomorrow. What time?
3:00.
3:00.
Yeah, but Panera's really good that way.
Yeah, for some fun times.
Sure.
It was always wonderful, and you always had a gathering of tarot psychic readers. Yeah, it was very good. So that, and what gave you the idea of the TarotCon? StarCon.
So tarot conferences have always been just a great time for people to get together. I went to my first tarot conference back in the 90s, and it was such an amazing thing to be with people from all over the world who speak my language.
Yeah.
And
your tribe.
Right. And it really felt like we needed such a thing in South Florida. Mm-hmm. That made sense. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of local tarot talent. Mm-hmm. And who wouldn't want to come to South Florida, right?
Yeah.
And then when COVID came, we realized we needed to do an online thing. And that has now sort of become our identity. We are the world's only multi-track hybrid conference, tarot conference.
And that's your doing, I think, right?
Well, that's COVID's doing.
Yeah, but that motivated you.
Absolutely.
To get the things to move it forward.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's how we hope to move forward.
That's pretty interesting. But going back to the roots, I heard you here tell about how you began with the tarot.
Oh, the University of the Grateful Dead, where I studied. Yes. Yeah, so back in the 80s, like many young people, I was very inspired by the music of the Grateful Dead, and like many young people, spent a lot of my time driving from show to show and hanging out in the parking lot and camping in the parking lot.
Yeah.
Well, not quite that. No, but I used to have a bumper sticker that said, "Who are the Grateful Dead and why do they keep following me?" And so, you know, I had a tarot deck and I had a book by Eden Gray in my backpack. And at some point, traveling through the Midwest in the wheat fields or the corn fields or something, I finally pulled out the book and started studying. And over time, I took some classes at a local New Age shop. I was living in New Haven, Connecticut at the mm-hmm. time. Mm-hmm. And I gave my first public readings in the parking lot of a Grateful Dead show. And that was really, that was like the first time I read for strangers. And yeah. you know, it's really in that, like you can read for your friends.
Right.
But you can always sort of think that you're using the cards to tell them what you already know. And we know that's not how it is, but when you're just learning, you know, you might think that.
Yeah.
But when you read for a stranger and you're able to give them their truth, that's when you know you really have something.
You're on to something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in that, you know, really interesting environment, the parking lot of a dead show in the 1980s was a very interesting place.
I'm sure there was a lot of energy.
That's one way of putting it. Yes.
And were you traveling alone or with companions?
At that point, there were six of us traveling together that particular summer. There were six of us traveling together, all from New Haven, mm-hmm. and we started out at a rainbow gathering in Ithaca, New York, and we were going to hitchhike and just meet up in different towns. We had no cell phones then, you know,
no.
so we'll just all hitchhike and we'll all meet up. We're hitchhiking in pairs, mm-hmm. and our first ride picked us all up. They had a really big vehicle. Took us to their house where we stayed for a couple of days, and they sold us a vehicle. For $400. I remember that. We ponied up $400 and bought this vehicle. It was one of those old, it was a slant six Valiant.
Oh my God.
Right?
That's
you know
not
what I'm
a big car.
About. Well,
and
it
you
fit the six of us.
It fit the six. You know, it's amazing that you could do that back then and come out alive to tell about it. Try that now. They'll find you dead on the side of the road. good times.
Indeed. Indeed.
So that was the beginning of your, and then you thought, maybe I could do this.
Well. I over many years, I was just reading for my friends, and then friends would bring friends, and, you know, they'd knock at the door and have brownies or a bottle of wine or something and say, you know, can you read for my friend? Can you give me a reading? Whatever. So it became known that I was good at this.
You built your reputation.
I did.
Started building.
And I met a guy. Mm-hmm. And at this point, I was a single mom. I had a young kid, and I was working in a bar. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, you know, you're a smart person. Why aren't you doing something, you know, with your intelligence? I was like, well, there's only one thing I'm good at. And I have no idea how to turn that into a job. So I told him what I did. And he said, oh, well, that's easy. And he called me up a couple days later and said, I'm going to come pick you up early Saturday morning. I got you a gig at a psychic fair.
So that was your first
gig. That's how it started. And now he's my husband and manages my business.
What a great story. So you're a team. He does the business end and you do the
right. He does all the tech stuff, all the number stuff, all the tech stuff.
I did want to mention also that she's a speaker at all these festivals.
Oh, sure.
And everything, and a TV and radio personality.
Yes, I have done my share of that. That's true.
Yeah. And do you enjoy that phase of it, that piece of it, or?
Yes and no. Mm-hmm. Yes and no.
How so?
I did not go as far with it as I could have because I always try to be genuine. And so if I'm going to do a reading on TV, I'm going to do a reading on TV. If I'm going to do a reading on radio, I'm doing that reading.
And you can't predict what's going to come out.
And that was all well and good.
Yeah.
But they wanted to put me in a turban. And they wanted me to be like their version of what a fortune teller should be.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm not doing
No.
That's not who I am. So I could not
You're
do that.
A natural gal. That's who you
That's
are.
It.
That's how you present.
Right.
Like it or leave it.
That's it.
So talk a little bit about your latest book. I'm interested in that.
Yeah, well, I will tell you this. You know that I do a weekly newsletter.
Yeah.
The Tarot Topics weekly
fan.
Newsletter. Yeah. I appreciate that. And one of the things that I like to put in the newsletters are different kinds of tarot exercises.
Yes.
What you can do with your cards to learn and to grow. It might be about a particular issue or situation. It might be about learning the cards. And I,
my friend Sue, who is here today, mm-hmm. and I, we do that once a week.
Right, right.
We work off that. And last week it was go deeper.
Right, right.
It was right. fabulous. So go on.
So I thought it would be interesting to create a book that really dives into all the different kinds of tarot exercises we can do. Tarot exercises to learn tarot, and then tarot exercises for personal growth, to stimulate creativity, all of that kind of thing. So if you enjoy that little snippet in my newsletter, you will enjoy this book.
That's good. So you have a wealth of, articles to choose from, material.
Well, I'm not going to recycle too much material.
No?
It's but the concept.
The concept.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And freshen the concept.
Yeah, I had a publisher say to me once, you shouldn't plagiarize yourself. Once something is published, you should not publish it again.
That's interesting. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
Very good. Yeah. So now your first book, talk a little bit about that.
Oh, so my first book, Fortune Steller, What Every Professional Tarot Reader Needs to Know. This was an interesting thing, and it was actually born of a tarot conference. I was a speaker at WATS, which was, it was a one-off conference, the Wisconsin Area Tri-State Tarot Symposium, back in 2000 and, I don't know, six-ish or something like that, where I met someone who got me a gig as a writer for Tarot World magazine, which no longer exists, but that's okay. I wrote an article for them, and the magazine editor reached out and asked me if I would write a book on how to be a professional tarot reader, and she was going to publish it, and then she went out of business right after I'd written the book. So I had this manuscript.
You had it, yeah.
And she went out of business. What was I going to do? So I found a small publisher to publish it, and it did very well, very well.
Because it's a niche category.
Sure, yeah. Sure. And then that publisher went out of business. And so I ended up updating it and self-publishing it. And honestly, I've really enjoyed self-publishing.
I've self-published and I'm a fan of it.
Yeah.
I am.
Absolutely.
Because you have creative control.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you make the money.
Right. Comes back in your pocketbook. No cuts to the middleman.
Right. Exactly.
I like it.
And now that said,
To take a moment from that, what about the marketing when you self-publish?
You got to do the marketing. Yeah. But you know what? When you traditionally publish, you have to do the marketing too. The publishers will say, it's our job to get the books on the shelves. It's your job to get them off. But I am also a fan of traditional publishing, and I've got a couple of projects in the works. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about
that
another time. So
yeah.
I'm a fan of both, really.
Yeah. Whatever works with the particular project.
Right, right.
So the second book.
Tarot Tour Guide. So that was the book that I had always wanted to write. Never did I want to write a book about how to be a professional tarot reader.
Right.
Although, given that I have been a full-time professional for so long.
Someone asked you to.
Right, it was a reasonable thing for me to write.
Yeah.
And that's interesting because it sort of put me in this space where, okay, that's like my thing. But it's only one of my things.
Yeah.
You
but
know?
That this is another one of your things, a writer.
Right.
Not every tarot reader can write well to write a book as you do.
Right. So Tarot Tour Guide was the book I really wanted to write. The subtitle is Tarot, the Four Elements in Your Spiritual Journey. So my whole take on things is the four elements, earth, air, fire, and water, are the cornerstones of my spiritual understanding and experience. And of course, they're also the cornerstones of tarot and astrology. And so I really wanted to write this book about how tarot can be a guide on our spiritual journey, and how the four elements is our way in to understand tarot, and our way in to understand life. And so I did that.
Book number two.
Yep.
On to book number three.
Right.
You're helping people learn about mediumship and more.
And how to work with tarot in all of those ways.
And this was your own idea, your own concept?
Absolutely.
Because that's what you've come to in your practice.
Right.
So you figure, write it up. And that's what you did with us today, right? At the meeting.
Yeah.
That was great.
Yeah, we talked about divination, mediumship, and self-care.
All great topics.
Right.
Yeah, very good. So you have a lot going for you. And what do you forecast in your own future?
Well, my goal at this point, you know, well, and this is funny. I had the honor of presenting at the Omega Institute this summer alongside of Mary Kay Greer and Rachel Pollack for their Masters of Tarot conference. Mm. And I was having a conversation with someone there about, you know, as we're getting older, that at some point it's time to step back and pass the torch. And my answer to that was, you can have my torch when you claw it out of my cold, dead hand.
That is so funny, because one of the things I spoke to you of my concerns, I'm tired, should I retire? And then I'll be bored.
Right.
And you go, never,
never
retire.
Never. Nope.
Get balance in your life,
that's
but
right.
do not retire.
Exactly. And so what I hope to see for myself is doing what I'm doing, writing, leading a conference, teaching, doing readings, traveling to do readings for as long as I possibly can.
Yeah. And enjoying it.
That's it.
I know you enjoy it.
That's it.
Have fun. My number one rule. Yeah. Yeah. Or you wouldn't be doing it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I noticed that you return to places where you used to live.
Yes.
Like the Tampa area.
Like the Tampa
like
area.
Connecticut.
Yep, Connecticut.
Where you're from.
Yes.
So I see you built up clientele in these areas. Mm-hmm. You built a name for yourself.
Well, yeah. So I do work. I do most of my work, actually, by phone.
Who do you want to reply to?
Siri. Phone, Skype, FaceTime, Messenger, Zoom. I do most of my work that way. But I also see people in my office in Palm City. And as much as I don't need to travel to places to do readings for people, because we could do it on Zoom.
Yeah.
It's nice.
There's nothing like like an in-person meeting.
And so
I've been to your office. Mm-hmm. It's lovely. And you showed me that from your office you do both. You'll have an in-person, and it'll be zoomed out also.
Absolutely.
Best of both worlds.
And while I'm traveling, like I did a Zoom reading in my car before I got here.
Oh my God.
Right? So it's always both. But I like the opportunity to meet new people. Mm-hmm. And that's a way that happens. I like an opportunity to be in places that I enjoy. And so it works out.
Yeah, it's very nice. So you've created like a really lovely lifestyle around the tarot.
Absolutely, right? Yeah. And I do, I mean, I pretty much work 7 days a week.
You do?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Wow.
But you know what they say? If you love what you do, you never work a day in your life.
Yes,
so
and I believe that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
So you told us some pretty interesting news at the meetup.
Not sharing yet.
Not sharing? Okay, yeah, too much here. Yeah.
That's for later.
Okay, that'll be for later. So what else would you like to talk about?
So let's talk for a minute just about tarot and what tarot is. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you know, it has a very specific history. Tarot started as a game.
I used to give talks on the history.
That's right.
The art and the history of the tarot.
That's right. Started as a game in Italy and is really a very young method of divination. Esoteric tarot has only been with us since the 1700s. Mm-hmm. And yet, when we look at a 78-card tarot deck, we can see within it pretty much everything that a person might encounter in life.
Absolutely.
Shows up in tarot.
Yeah.
And the way that we can use tarot you know, certainly there is tarot divination, reading for yourself, reading for a friend, getting a professional reading. That is a very powerful thing. But the images of tarot can speak to us in so many ways. We can look at the images and find wisdom there. Find lessons there. In many ways, tarot is a book of spiritual
just
wisdom.
Just studying the picture on the card.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there are so many variations of
right.
cards.
Right. There are literally thousands and thousands of tarot decks, so each artist has its own take.
Who is that artist who's always doing new decks? He was at the con.
Well, there are so many artists who are always doing new decks, but I bet you you're talking about the one and only Ciro Marchetti.
I am. I am. Exactly.
And he is one of our Florida treasures. We
and
love Ciro.
He must have done a number himself of different decks.
He has. And he's going to hate me for not knowing this. There's been an Oracle, a Kipper, one or two Lenormands, and maybe 9 tarot decks, and quite a few. And it's funny, I met him when he was working on his third deck. He started with Gilded Tarot, which is still his most popular. Then he did Tarot of Dreams, I believe. And then he was working on Legacy of the Divine. And that's when I interviewed him, because my column in Tarot World Magazine was, it was called Sneak Peek. It was taking a look at decks before they're published.
Uh-huh.
So I was interviewing deck authors, deck artists, mm-hmm. To talk about their forthcoming decks. And I had called up Ciro, and he invited me to his home, which, like, being in his home is like being inside one of his tarot decks. It's
wow.
It's really pretty amazing what it looks like in there. And I interviewed him, and he said, you know, this is the deck. I'm going to get it right. It's going to be my last deck. It was
famous
not,
last words.
It was not his last deck, and we're
glad
it was not his
really?
Last deck. He is just a brilliant artist.
He is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. It was pretty amazing to meet him in person. Now, today you showed a new deck that you were saying is the most popular.
Well, it is very popular right now.
Did that come out at the con?
No.
No.
No. It's Lightseer's Tarot by Chris Ann. And it has become a very popular deck. It's a fairly new deck over the past few years. But we're really loving this deck. We're loving the artwork.
Yeah.
And it's very inclusive. You know, one of the problems with traditional tarot is, well, you know, there used to be this hashtag, tarot so white.
Oh,
right? Because tarot would primarily feature
again, because it came from Europe. It was born in Europe.
Right. And so modern tarot now is really trying to correct that.
I like that.
And, you know, beyond that, tarot was very sort of gender normative. And so now, Lightseer's Tarot being a great example of this, but there are others as well. Aunt Lily's Tarot is another one that pictures all kinds of people. People of different races,
that's
people of different
great.
Ages, people of different sizes,
and
people of varying genders and different kinds of relationships, because that's who we are.
That's who we are today.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
our population.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that. I'm so excited to hear it.
Yeah, so that's really, I think, like today, if a tarot artist were to publish a deck of all white, straight, thin people in 2022, I think they would probably just be a jerk.
Yeah.
I really, there's just no place for that
no,
now.
There's no. Oh, that's great news.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm really happy. Yeah. Now, you mentioned a few words I would like you to explain when you were talking about the decks. That is a Ciro.
Mm-hmm. Lenormand and Kipper.
Yes,
okay.
Please explain that.
Sure. So Lenormand, and actually I'm giving it an American pronunciation. You really should pronounce that with a French accent, like Lenormand.
Lenormand.
Right.
Okay.
Is a strictly fortune-telling deck. It's actually the Petit Lenormand. It's 36 cards. There is also a Grand Lenormand, which is much bigger. But it's the Petty, the 36 card deck that has become very popular in the past few years. Unlike tarot.
Yeah, how is it different?
First of all, it was designed to be a fortune-telling deck. So it's got very specific traditions, comes out of Europe, and there's a French tradition and a German tradition. It is named after Mademoiselle Marie Lenormand, who was a fortune teller, I believe, for Napoleon and in his court. Wow. She never read with this deck. It's named after her.
Right.
It's patterned after a card game called the Game of Hope, which was a sort of Christian-based card-playing game. So in that way, like tarot, but intentionally made as a fortune-telling device. So there's that.
There's that.
And then Kipper really deals with situations. Kipper is also a fortune-telling device card deck that comes out of Germany. So if you think about it, tarot speaks in metaphor. Lenormand is things, right? There's the book, the dog, the key, right, things.
Oh.
Kipper more speaks to situations, but is also a fortune-telling deck that was designed to be a fortune-telling deck.
Mm.
So these are our other traditions of cartomancy.
And then there's the oracle deck.
So here's, okay, that's a very good point. So the word oracle is an interesting word.
It is. Not your everyday word.
An oracle can be a fortune-telling tool, a fortune teller.
Yes.
A place where fortune telling is done.
Ah.
Or the message that is given in fortune telling.
So it can be a noun, an adjective, and a verb.
It's all those things,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So tarot is an oracle. But in modern times, we use the word oracle to describe a deck of cards that was created for divination, but not following any specific pattern or tradition. So if you wanted to create an oracle deck, you know, so it basically means this is a deck of cards with which you can do divination, and it's not tarot, and it's not Lenormand, and it's not Kipper. It's
so
a thing you made up.
You might just think of a theme, a focus,
and have a bunch of cards,
let's
and there it would
nature,
be.
Right.
You
know, yeah.
And that would be the deck, and there it would be. And so it is kind of a misuse of the word, because tarot is an oracle.
Yeah.
But for simplicity, that's what we do.
Okay. Wow. It's a whole world, the world of tarot.
And that's why we have conferences.
Yes. Yes. And to learn all about everything and to grow and move forward, like you said, with the introduction of the new decks with the current population that we're living with.
Absolutely.
That's wonderful. Wonderful. So let me see, what else is there about you that I need to find out?
Well,
I wrote down all your things. She's a headliner. She's a popular psychic. She's a host of a podcast. She's an author of 2 going on 3 books.
Mm. Well, and then hopefully many more after that. That is.
You like that, yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting. Did you study writing at any point in your life?
I mean, I've taken some classes.
Yeah.
And in fact, when I was a child, my grandmother said I would be a writer. That was her take on it. Yeah.
Did that run in your family by any chance, the psychic?
You know, I think it did.
But not recognized.
Right, the women in my family, most certainly. My mother, my grandmother. And in fact, and this is an interesting thing, there's an expression in my family, on my mother's side of the family. My mother and my grandmother would say, "Be careful or they'll hang you for a witch." Mm. And I've never heard that expression anywhere else, but it was often said in my family.
In your family.
When you would...
Well, you know it has been done.
It has been done. But why would that be an expression in my family? And it's something that would be said if you said, you know, I had a dream, and then this happened, or you know, that yeah. kind of thing.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think there was a lot of ability in my family to prophecy and to to know things, but I'm the only one who has really studied and practiced divination
really,
on that
really
level.
Deep, yeah. deep.
Yeah.
You went deep.
I did. Yeah. And I did.
Okay. I wonder if there are any questions from the audience.
I think you covered it really well.
You think we covered everything? Is there anything you'd like to add?
No, just to say thank you so much for spending this time with me and for having me teach in your garden. I really appreciate that.
It's my pleasure to have you, and I want to thank you. Well, I do like to do a Zen moment, so we're going to have like a moment of silence.
Okay.
That's a Zen moment, and then we can say goodbye.
Okay.
Okay, I think that's a wrap.